sing your song, sing out for me.
This is your second project with Soul Savers. It's called Angels and Ghosts. Tell me about this album and how it came together.
Well, after we finished the last record, The Light of the Dead Sea, we basically continued writing. We never really stopped writing together. Soul Savers is basically Rich Machin and Ian Glover. It's a sort of production team. And then they use a lot of different musicians to kind of come together on their projects. And Rich approached me a few years ago to do the first one, and you know, it just seemed natural to do another one as well. You know, like I said, the writing never really stopped. We had some ideas, but I kind of put all that stuff on hold because I was about to start recording a new album with Depeche Mode with my band, and so I kind of had to say to Rich, look, we'll come back to another record, but right now I'm doing this. And a Depeche Mode project is, you're going to make a record which is going to take about a year, and then you're going to be on the road for about a year. So it was some time before we managed to get back together again and continue this process, which has become Angels and Ghosts.
But the Soul Savers, they do have a very distinctive sound. But once Dave Gahan is in there with that signature sound, and it fits nice with the production, it's very hard to distinguish.
Yeah.
Because you're so Depeche Mode. So is it impossible to change your voice so it doesn't sound the same? How do you distinguish it?
You know, when you're writing a song, the instrumentation that you're writing to and the type of music that... I mean, to be honest, a lot of the music that even Depeche makes, it's steeped in gospel and blues as well, and a lot of those influences come into the music, so it's not that far away. Mm-hmm. But this is very... It's a lot more, you know, we use a lot more guitars and old organs and you know, drums and gospel singers. And we have Martin Lenoble playing bass with us. So it's all, this is all live musicians around my voice. And when I'm writing with Rich, he does a lot of the ideas he gives me are either on guitar or they're simple organ lines. So there's a lot of space and a lot of atmosphere to me to be able to kind of use and create ideas to.
It makes me think about that period in 2004 where you went to Depeche Mode and said, look, I need to be involved in the writing.
Yeah.
And if I'm not involved in the writing, I don't know if I want to stick around. So my question for you now is, why did it take 25 years for you to get your first songwriting credit, and how does it feel now that you can really expand with Depeche Mode and do other projects too?
Right. I mean, it's a good question because, you know, it wasn't that I didn't have ideas that I wanted to develop myself, but, you know, all those years of working with somebody, with Martin Gore, who's a fantastic songwriter, and I felt very comfortable in that role that I had, which was basically providing the vocals and the atmosphere with my voice to the songs that he was writing.
Okay.
And then, you know, I went off and did a solo album, which was Paper Monsters.
Right.
And when I came back from doing that album, I realized I'd opened a door that I couldn't really close. So it was kind of like, can we meet halfway here?
Right.
And I think at the time, you know, to Martin and even the whole team behind Depeche Mode, it was kind of like a bit of a threat, you know, or something like, hey, let's not kind of change it up too much here. We've got something that's working, you know. But for me as an artist, I kind of had to... It wasn't just to stop being with Depeche Mode. It was like, I've got to kind of, you know, spread my wings a bit here, and I want you to be on board with me, but... You know, and I need you to do this. So Martin kind of edged my way in there. And now, after all these years, I guess 10 years later, 12 years later, we share that kind of place together. And I think that what's happened is it's become more like a team. Mm-hmm. And Martin and I are a team in the studio where we know we're both going to be bringing our songs in, and we can work on those songs together.
And
as
it didn't hurt that your first song, Suffer Well, was nominated for a Grammy.
Well, I think that probably helped, you know, to sort of nudge them in the right direction of like, okay, he's doing okay here, yeah.
What do you think of streaming and file sharing, and how has that impacted you as an artist, both for Soul Savers and Depeche Mode?
Well, yeah, we've sort of been around long enough to see the change happen. And, you know, look, we're a band, my band as well, Depeche Mode, it's like we were pushing against all that kind of idea of what music was supposed to sound like many, many years ago when we were kind of making electronic music and performing in electronic. We came up against a lot of resistance against that because it wasn't the norm.
Right, and with mixes.
Yeah, everything about it, remixing and stuff like that, everything we were doing, it was like, well, wait a minute, who's playing the bass? Like, where's the drummer? You know, we had a lot of that, especially in the States. And but so we had to work through that. So my point is, you know, technology is here and it changes all the time. And you can either use the information or you can just be afraid of it.
Yeah,
and,
I mean, you've had an open format approach, but I guess coming in and writing your first official song with the group in 2005, and then boom, all of a sudden downloading comes.
Oh, well,
you probably lost out on a lot of publishing royalties.
Well, you know, that hit us all. I mean, and it still does. And but it's changing a little. Once again, it's changing again. Now, like you say, there's streaming. That's become the new thing. And I think what has to happen is the industry has to change, and artists need to be compensated for their work. And that's what it is. It's work, it's our writing, it's our lives. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you're a new artist and you're coming up, you have to make sure when you sit down there and you sign those contracts with whoever it is you're signing your contracts with, that you make sure that you get something written in there that covers all those bases. Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, you know, you've got to get paid for your work.
Right. and it's great to talk to you about this because you've been in the industry for more than 30 years. And when I tell people I'm going to see a Depeche Mode show or I'm interviewing Dave Gahan, they say, oh, some people say, oh, they were big in the 80s, and they don't even realize that you're still doing arenas and stadiums.
Right.
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 How have you been able to keep that, you know,
well,
that?
We always,
that
you
momentum.
Know, we've always sneaked in the back door. You know, it's like our music has always been on the outside, and you know, we have always kind of maintained that. And through everything that's happened, in, certainly in the last 30 years within the music industry, what we've always retained is our performing presence. And we always have been a band that's gone out there and performed, and our fans know that they're going to go and see a show that they're going to go away with it, as a memory.
Yeah.
And that they're not going to be disappointed. And I think that's been the lasting power of this band.
Yeah.
Not just the songwriting, but the fact that we've become a band that could perform. I mean, the last tour that we did, the Delta Machine tour,
right,
we played to more people than we've ever played to around the world.
And how old are you?
How old am I now? I'm in my 50s. I'm 53.
Okay, you're in your 50s.
I'm getting on.
You're up there ripping your shirt off,
but up here,
sweating.
It's crazy up here. I don't know. I don't feel that much older than my daughter.
Yeah. Well, what's your workout routine? Because you do have a certain level of intensity on the show that you don't see for young people.
Well, that comes to me through the music. It really does. It's like when I go on stage, no matter how I'm feeling, I just, you know, I'm still way behind this. Like, Mick Jagger still gets up there and does his thing. I know he's hurting afterwards, trust me. I know the next morning he's like, what the hell am I doing?
Right.
But there's something about it. It does keep you kind of young and youthful. Music is a wonderful thing for the spirit, but I kind of pride myself on putting a lot of energy into what I do on stage. You know, making music is like, you know, it's not work, really. It's a fun thing to do. And when you hit it and when you really find that place and you create something, as I know you know, there's nothing quite like it.
Well, there are so many bands, however, that have not been able to hold it together through the 30 years. You've had your personal challenges. You had drug addiction issues. Mm. Martin had alcoholism.
Right.
Andy had depression issues, but you're still together. And to me, it feels like hopefully the worst is behind you. So does that mean that this band is going to stay together?
I guess it's
forever in
absolute
perpetuity,
madness. Or? It's madness that keeps us together. I'm sure. It's partly being slightly unhinged, but you know, I think most people that get involved in things that are creative have got this overactive mind, and you know, hopefully now we're putting it into, you know, it just all into the music. I know that, you know, Martin has changed his ways as well, and he's been sober for a number of years now. So when we go into the studio, it's all about work. And, you know, we had our fair share of, you know, going out there and partying and having fun and stuff and when we were younger. And to be honest, that is a young man's game, you know. It's,
I know, believe me.
So, you know, when we get together now, it's really...
So what is your relationship like? I sense an interdependence, mm-hmm. a creative interdependence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But when you're on the road and stuff, are you guys like friends? Are you business associates? Are you family members? Because you grew up together. Well, how do you
It's like
it?
A family. It's like okay. a dysfunctional family that sometimes it comes together. We all get around the dinner table and it can be great. And then there's just those moments where it's like, you know, we're throwing food at each other. That hasn't really changed that much. I would say as we've got older, you just kind of, you know, you do your own thing and you come together and, like I said, you do the work and that's what's important, you know. One thing is when we get up on stage together, we all feel the same way. We got to put on the best show we can.
Yeah, that's clear. That's
and
evident.
that's really where it's at. I mean, we're still fortunate to be able to have the opportunity to do that after all these years. Like you said, a lot of those bands... You know, where are they now? You know?
Yeah, I mean, even from a business standpoint, just to keep everything together.
And we have great
gotta
people.
It's got to be different than it was. I mean, when you're playing these clubs and probably couldn't scrape two nickels together, and now
10 years,
your last
the first
tour
10 years,
grossed $30 million on your last tour.
Right, yeah. Well, on the last, when we were kids, I mean, in that first 10 years, I mean... I don't think we still had two pennies to rub together. But, you know, you do go from tour to do album to album. We were doing okay and everything was going well. But it wasn't really till after that we started making some money. I'd say 10 years in. But
okay.
A lot
because
of
the concerts mainly? And...
Concerts, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, concerts. And, you know, back in those days, you sold records. And we, you know, we had a couple of big records, you know, in the early sort of late 80s, early 90s, Violator, Songs of Faith and Devotion.
25 years. For Violator, right?
Yeah, exactly. We, you know, so
crazy.
Long time.
But I talked to the Depeche Mode fan club in New York City because every month they have a Depeche Mode party and it's all Depeche Mode all night. They even have a boat party over there on the pier here in New York. So I have people from all over the world that have submitted some questions.
They do this in many countries, actually, in the world.
Oh, yeah.
Specific nights they have, like... You know, these big parties where people get together and they play all the music. Sometimes like 5,000-10,000 people.
Andy McMinn wants to say, I would just like to ask Dave Gahan, does he get frustrated with Depeche Mode in between tours? Does he want to be more active with Depeche instead of the usual 3-year gap that now comes in between each album? Mm. Is this why he's done 2 solo albums and now collaborating with Soul Savers for the second time? Or is the time span between each Depeche Mode project a much-needed rest by all the band before setting out on another DM project and tour?
Well, really, you answered the question with the last part there. It really, when we get together to work on a record, first of all, even the writing process itself, which, you know, loosely has already begun. I know Martin's been writing a little, I've been writing a little, you know, for whatever will be the next project. That takes time. Then once we get together and put a team together in the studio with whatever producer's going to work on that record, whatever programmers are going to work on that record, that takes time. Then we go on tour. And that whole period is about 3 years.
Right.
You know,
okay.
So we really do need a break from each other afterwards and just to go away and take it all in.
Right.
And for me, I continue writing all the time. So I've been fortunate enough to, in between those, as this guy says, those records, to work on things that have just really enabled me to grow as a songwriter as well, mm-hmm. and an artist, so that when I come back to working on whatever the next project is with Depeche Mode, I come back enthusiastic about, okay, what can we do with this to shift it and make it a little different? So one thing about Depeche Mode is over the years, we've always had these moments where we've had to change a little or had to rethink our idea or how we recorded, you know, whether that was somebody leaving the band, like in the beginning, Vince Clarke, then later on, Alan Wilder. They were big shifts that, you know, forced us to have to rethink how we recorded in the studio.
Okay. Nughet Yavuz, I hope I pronounced your name correctly, congrats on your new album with Soul Savers. Your daughter, Stella Rose, has a great voice. Would you consider doing an album with her? You would make a great duo.
She would say, no way, Dad. Yeah. Just get the hell away from me. Okay. She does have a great voice, and if that's something she wants to pursue, I know that she could. If she asked me for help, I would certainly do the best I could to help her, but she doesn't need my help. She's amazing, Stella Rose. Okay. She's got her own thing going on.
Okay, Cecilia Castro from Argentina. I've been Dave's fan since I was a child. My friends appear since 2001 in each DVD with the Argentinian flag. In this album, did he try to reflect something about the past? The title is so suggestive.
You know what? It's interesting because the title, yeah, Angels and Ghosts, is to me, angels represent all the relationships and things that go on around me now that are informative. And to me, the ghosts are the memories, of past and also of the present that we carry with us. And they're, you know, ultimately the only things that we can take away with us from this from this world when we're dead and gone.
Jamie MacDonald wants to know, Depeche Mode means fashion forward. And he says...
That's my fault. I stole the name from a magazine.
From a magazine that you saw, right?
Exactly. I was at art college back in 1978 and taking a fashion course, actually. And at the time, my band was, I think, 79 it must have been. But we needed a name. And we were doing a few club gigs in London and stuff. And I remember at one point... This guy from a club in London asked me, he said, okay, you know, you got on the B list, you got a gig, you're going to be opening for somebody, maybe. What's the name of the band? Because he'd heard our tape. And we were called at the time, the band at the time was called Composition of Sound, which was a bit of a mouthful, and we were looking for something different. And that magazine just was sitting there right next to me, and I just read it off the top. Okay. And he was like, what? And I was like, yeah, Depeche Mode. And he was like, what? And I thought, okay, this is good because it's
okay, good. Well, and Jamie wondered, who's the most fashionable member of Depeche Mode, in your opinion?
Oh, it's got to be me, isn't it?
With the leather coat, I think I would say so. I always wonder about when I go in and I see these huge stadiums full of people that know the words to all of the songs and everything. Do you feel that you get enough radio time now? And does that even matter? Because it's harder to chart.
Yeah.
Well, and I don't know what that's about.
Well, like we talked about earlier, you know, it's a different... especially younger people, they listen to music in a very different way. You know, I see it with my own kids. It's... there is a lot of streaming and stuff like that where people listen. I mean, my kids actually listen to albums more, but that might be my influence as well with them. But... you know, I've kind of always said that to me. You've got to listen to a whole album. You can't just listen to one song. Like, check out the album. And, you know, my daughter, you know, is, like, you know, like Florence and the Machine, Lana Del Rey, you know, she listens to the albums.
Okay.
You know, which I think, and Beyonce, she's a big fan of as well. She listens to the albums. I always try and say there's more to, you know, the artist than just this one song. You might want to check it out because you might not like what you hear. Mm-hmm. And you might really like what you hear and check out something else. I think that the radio thing, it's different. It's different today. I don't really understand it, to be honest.
It's not something that you need, but I've heard, you know, like, for instance, Prince, he's talked a lot about his frustration with...
Yeah.
With well, it's the large not as, syndicated
yeah,
radio.
It's not as black and white anymore as what it was. I mean, back in the day, we used to, you know, if you had someone here in New York playing a song to death, you know, you could have some success in New York City and come play here, but that might not translate over on the West Coast. You know, there'd be another station over there. And, you know, in the early days, we had that, you know, WDRE, here on Long Island, and out in LA there, it was K-Rock, which was a tiny little station then. But now, yeah, the syndication, you know, they have their playlists, and that's what's kept... So it's difficult to get in there. Still, the best way to get out there and to get your band, you know, heard is you got to go out there and play some gigs.
All right, Dave, looking forward to it. Thanks for coming in, man.
All right, thanks. Yeah, bring it in.
Special day for us.
Thanks,
all right,
man.
Thanks, man. I'm on a new set.